If we take a walk to the center of the town square, you'll notice a beautiful statue of Minnie Mouse and a striking gentleman. No, it's surprisingly not Walt, but his brother Roy. This statue is known as Sharing the Magic, and the plaque reads, Sharing the Magic, dedicated to Roy O. Disney, co-founder of the Walt Disney Company. In 1923, Walt and his brother Roy O. Disney pooled their resources, Walt's creative vision and Roy's business sense, to form their own cartoon studio. Together, they successfully pioneered many new avenues in family entertainment. Roy O. Disney completed his brother's last and greatest dream, the creation of the Walt Disney World Resort, and dedicated the Magic Kingdom on this site on October 25th, 1971. The statue was sculpted by Imagineer Blaine Gibson and was erected in October 1999. To the left-hand side of the Roy statue is the Walt Disney World dedication plaque, which reads, Walt Disney World is a tribute to the philosophy and life of Walter Elias Disney, and to the talents, the dedication, and the loyalty of the entire Disney organization that made Walt Disney's dream come true. May Walt Disney World bring joy and inspiration and new knowledge to all who come to this happy place, a magic kingdom where the young at heart of all ages can laugh and play and learn together. Dedicated this 25th day of October 1971, Roy O. Disney. The flagpole located here is the site where daily flag retreat ceremonies are held. Occurring daily at around 5 p.m., it's a moving and patriotic event which involves a color guard lowering and folding the American flag. Veterans are often invited to take part in this flag retreat ceremony, and guests can inquire at City Hall for more information or to see how you can be a part of it. As we begin our tour around the town square in a clockwise direction, we'll start with the Grand Walt Disney World Railroad Station. Walt Disney was a big railroad fan, going so far as to have a 1/8 scale model called the Carrollwood Pacific in his backyard home in the Holmby Hills section of Los Angeles. So it's fitting and important that this railroad station be not only the first thing you see as you approach the park, but be so grand in size that it presides over the entrance with incredibly detailed authentic props, architecture, and stories of Walt and other people and their passion for railroading. The first floor of the station is filled with wonderful details and hidden treasures that the casual guest often overlooks. There are maps showing a variety of real railways that cross the United States, as well as the Walt Disney World Railroad route. Here you can find four posters depicting the four steam engines that ply the Walt Disney World Railways and learn more about them. When Walt Disney built Disneyland, he, with the help of the Santa Fe Railroad Company, constructed the Santa Fe and Disneyland Railroad, a 5/8 scale live steam train railroad that circled the park. When he was developing Walt Disney World for Florida, he also wanted it to include steam trains as well. Disney Imagineers looked for steam trains that could be refurbished and used in the Magic Kingdom to transport guests. During their quest, they traveled to Mexico in 1969 and purchased 5 steam trains from the United Railways of Yucatan. They were transported to Florida and in just 2 years were magically transformed into Victorian-era trains grand enough to bear the Walt Disney name. The Walt Disney World Railroad also bears the distinction of being the first attraction to be completed for Walt Disney World. The trains on the Walt Disney World Railroad are, number 1, the Walter E. Disney. This red steam engine was built by the Baldwin Locomotive Works in 1925. Number 2 is the Lily Bell, named after Walt's wife. It was built by the Baldwin Locomotive Works in 1928 and is painted green. Number 3 is the Roger E. Brogy. The engine on this train is also red with yellow trim, and it too was built in 1925 by the Baldwin Locomotive Works. It's named after Walt Disney's first Imagineer and friend, who helped him build his miniature trains in the studio machine shop and later install them in his backyard. He also did extensive work on the creation of audio animatronics, special effects, and Epcot Center. The Roy O. Disney is number 4 and is the only American-style steam engine, is painted blue, and it was also built by the Baldwin Locomotive Works in 1916. In 1977, the number 5 Ward Kimball became the last train to be added to the fleet. It was built by the Davenport Locomotive Works in 1927, but was found to be too small for operation on the Walt Disney World Railroad line. It was displayed in Epcot briefly in 1996, but later traded for a Forney locomotive that's currently in use on the Disneyland Railroad line. In the first floor hallway, you can see a train bulletin hanging on the wall, which is a true hidden treasure. The arriving and departing trains on each row pay subtle homage to a number of Disney films and characters, as well as some other Disney legends and train aficionados. The first row shows trains arriving from Grizzly Bear Flats and departing to Kimball Canyon. Legendary animator Ward Kimball, like Walt Disney, was also a railroad enthusiast and, like Walt, built a miniature train line in his backyard called the Grizzly Flats Railroad. The trains departing for Sidon City and arriving from Hickory is a direct reference to the 1966 film Follow Me Boys, which featured a character named Lemuel Siddons who lived in the town of Hickory. Fans of The Absent-Minded Professor and its sequel Son of Flubber will recognize the names of Medfield as the college in the film and Rutledge as likely being a contraction of the name Rutland College, the school's rival. Another Disney film, Pollyanna, was set in the town mentioned in the next row, Harrington Hills. Pendergrass Plains refers to the reclusive character Mr. Pendergrass. Trains arriving from Bullwhip and leaving for Griffin Gulch make direct reference to the 1967 film The Adventures of Bullwhip Griffin, starring Roddy McDowall. Take some time to explore the rest of the train station and look at the props that chronicle the history of both the American and Disney railroads. On the second floor of the station, where you board the Walt Disney World Railroad, you can find a number of wonderful artifacts and antiques, such as old mutoscopes, including some that were once found in the Main Street Penny Arcade, a J.P. Seberg player piano from 1927, wonderful artwork, and more. From the tall, curved ceilings hang globed chandeliers, while detailed marble floors and intricate woodwork complete the scene of a turn-of-the-century railroad station. The entire building is filled with rich history, not only of some of the people who helped create the magic, but the history of the park they helped design and the history of American railroading. As we step out from the train station onto Main Street USA, we'll start our tour in a clockwise direction from our left-hand side. One of the first things you'll see is my personal favorites in all of Walt Disney World and continues the storytelling that began as we entered the park. Because like any good theater, you need a place right up front to get your popcorn, and call it nostalgia, but here's where I consider to be the best place to get popcorn in all of Walt Disney World. It may be the location, it may be the old-style Red Wagon, but the Orville Redenbacher popcorn cart is a must-do as you wander through Town Square. Did you know that more than 275,000 pounds of popcorn are served in Walt Disney World each year? That's enough for about 5 million individual servings and could just about fill Space Mountain from floor to ceiling. Behind the cart is the Main Street Galleria, which is now used for package pickup. That means that if you make purchases while in the park and don't want to carry them around all day, they can be sent to the front of the park for you to pick up on your way out at no extra cost. This building at one time was the home to the Main Street Art Gallery, and prior to that, the SunTrust Bank Building. To the right is a covered walkway, which houses an area sometimes used for character greetings, including a great place to find Santa Claus during Mickey's Very Merry Christmas Party. You can also take a number of tours given by Disney that take you through and in some cases behind the scenes at the Magic Kingdom. Many of these tours meet and begin from here daily. Next to the Galleria is City Hall, and like any American town, City Hall is where you're going to find help and the city's administration. Here, it's known as Guest Relations, and it's where you can get information, make dining reservations, buy tickets, exchange currency, and get almost any question you have answered. Inside, you can also find an ATM, park maps in dozens of different languages, and even a large map of the park in Braille. Past the restrooms adjacent to City Hall is the Main Street Firehouse. Aptly named Company No. 71 for the year Walt Disney World opened, it houses a merchandise shop filled with fire department themed items. Unlike Disneyland's version, atop which was Walt Disney's personal apartment, the Walt Disney World version has no apartment above it. It does, however, have many props and decorations that one would find in a firehouse of the era, as well as dedications to the fallen heroes of 9/11. The store also has display cases filled with hundreds of fire department patches from around the world, traditionally donated by visiting guests. As you walk through the store into the back, be sure to look at the old ladder leading to the foe's sleeping quarters upstairs, as well as the traditional brass fire pole. Here, you'll also find a selection of souvenirs for your favorite pet. Now, if you continue to circle around the plaza, that's where you're going to find the car barn, which is where the Main Street vehicles leave from. Don't hesitate to walk up and look around, as it's a real working barn decorated with working harnesses and bridles for the horse-drawn carriages that ply Main Street USA. Looking inside, you really get a sense of the turn-of-the-century architecture and theming, including the quaint checkerboard perched atop a barrel, boxes of horseshoe nails, and simple lights reminiscent of the turn of the century.